Ghostly memories of my mother's painful screaming sometimes wake me in full moonlight when my room's gray and blue and the night is cresting toward morning. Lying awake in the darkness, I wonder if the whites of my eyes are glowing, if a person watching me can see them pierce the black. Our first house stood surrounded by harsh brown weeds which frame all surviving pictures. My mother crouching over me as I ride on a tricycle and squint into the camera. A dog licking my arm as I jerk away so fast my body blurs into white and gray. The house in the background is dingy and small, stuccoed and peeling. A large old car sometimes appears in the photographs. A few letters and numbers mark the license plate. The house is gone today, a pile of man-made bones ritually buried under asphalt. Stuck by behind bare ground. Once, as a teenager, I went to see it and wandered around inside. Only the dusty floor and memories of other families came out to greet me. Upon touching my arms with spidery fingers, they shrank away quickly. I was not the spirit they knew, not the familiar well of their dwindling consciousness. In an otherwise empty cabinet, I discovered an old bottle which had held for me. This box of photographs is all that remains for me. My parents split up soon after I was born. Here's a picture of my father in suspenders with his shirt sleeves rolled up. See how his hat covers most of his forehead. He stands surrounded by a green field. On the back he wrote, "To my girl, California is the promised land." This is the last picture of my mother. She wears a pale dress and gloves while sitting on a bench in front of a rose garden. Her face has the expression of a condemned prisoner. Her eyes do not see the photographer or the roses or the insect flitting in front of her. Somewhere not in the picture, outside that microcosmic world, I am five and looking out a cold, white-edged window and asking Santa Claus to bring my mother home. Or I'm almost five and wishing with tight, bald hands over a fake wishing well in front of Aunt Meg's yard for my father to come. Soon after my 10th birthday, my parents began to fade from my head. That is when the photographs became important to me, when the real world began to seem hazy and fast, like a white stick of lightning piercing the prairie sky. Stronger in memory than we like. I do not know what pleases me. I do not know what to make of this rich world of red and white checkered tablecloths and old radios and dusty gutters and pale blue farmhouses ringed with sunflowers. I do not know what to make of my family or their newspapers or their homemade soap or their long I do not know why I sometimes feel so far away. of myself as the dead are known to do. After I gave up wishing for my father, I began to wish for impossible things. A silvery ferry, a 30-day rainstorm, a paper sailboat big enough to ride in. Some of these things came true. I blamed the big rain on my own foolishness. And there's a blue angel on top of the motel not too far from here. So when the roadman came kicking up dust down the main road in front of the house, I thought for sure that he was another conjuration. I thought for sure that if I stared at him long enough, he would disappear with a pricking noise, such as when pea pods are snapped open. But he didn't. He circled around for several days, like a hungry, searching crow. Some said he was seen drinking a beer at a local bar. Some said they saw him walking dirt off his pants out in the field. Some said he was the devil come for bad eggs. But I knew as soon as I saw him, the roadman came for me. While I lay clenched up into a ball in my bed, I heard his hoarse whisper like the whisper of an old man on a telephone. Come on and leave this world behind. I wondered then at the gift he gave me, at the message I could barely hear. I wondered about the vision I had of St. Elmo's fire dancing over the back of the fence. Thank you. What I have seen fills my heart with desire. The roadman comes for me.
Therefore, night shall be upon you, that ye shall not have a vision. And it shall be dark unto you, that ye shall not divine. The night clouds are thick and black. What know you, girl? What know you of the world and its clouds? The long, wild world asks everything, gives nothing. To pass through these gates has a terrible price. Remember, What doth the Lord require of thee but to do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with thy God? There is no more to be added to the measure. Hard, quiet work brings the righteous to their reward. You are what you speak. You speak desire. You become desire. All you are becomes wanting. All the wanting becomes what you are. And so it is mercy. When you stop, you that wide letter in the sky finds up all the dreams. All the dreams is bound up and found in your own heart's dreams. The cold world of the road never listens, never comes to watch. The cold grass goes out to sing. The smallest ants go on their feet. The world will never hear the dream. The world will never hear it.
This last voice echoing off the edge of a wave goodbye, leaving everything we have, everything we own, everything we are. That last note standing still, Sandberg said, it is so thin a splinter of sea. We will have some time to bundle up, to wait by the fire, to listen for the crack and hiss of shifting ice.
That which we love binds us.
The soft-fingered lad answered for me, held me in a breast and answered for me, saying on each side the same, the same.
It is neither the end of the road, nor the beginning of the road, but the center which tries us.
I've had a vision, a visit. The roadman came to me.
You know, I lived all my life in this beautiful country. Never once seen a roadman. Heard tales. Tales no better than last year's cotton. Don't believe it's real. You know what I think this road man is? Mad hysteria. Collecting sanity. Affects all people around him. All. Why do you want to go? Why do you want to leave this bountiful country? Why, a man might make a good, long living. Own his own home. Free and clear after 20 years. Clear as a bell. Where do you want to go? You must be afraid. Or maybe what you need is Jesus. You ever let Jesus into your heart? He'll take care of those devils dancing around your little head. Yes, indeed, every sin, everything, to take his cue from Jesus. Or maybe what you need is a good woman. That's the problem with these kids nowadays. Always whining and crying out, want, want, want. My name, we were so damn disrespectful. We worked hard, Lord, forgive me. Hard all our lives. Do you see these hands? Hey, do you see these hands? These are the hands that built this country. These are the arms that carried the babies and shouldered the sheep and cleaned the gutters and picked the apples and made the news. Do you think the world is going to turn on its axis to you? Men died for the life of youth. without plan. On a short road to hell with the devil. That's a good thing. A body is judged by the company it keeps. You want to be low level, white, rat, because that's where you're headed from. That's where you are headed. You need to make some hard choices. And you don't need no road man to make them for you. But you is the famous, famous, but not personal improvement course. This time right here inside of mine, you get a little bit of Amos, a little bit of Jesus, and a whole lot of old time, hallelujah, golden standing, life affirming, positive thinking. In fact, I'll take some bottle here, honey. I'll consider it down. Yes, indeed. Every sin and everything. God is taking you to Jesus.
Silvery, ghostly, gone in a flash of white moonlight on a still pond. I know what happened to the rest of the kittens. I know. I know about Amos McNaught and his burlap bag. And I won't let it happen again. Where am I now? There's the road in front of Aunt Meg's porch. Who's on it? What kind of magic is this? When will it end? Will it end with a pop or a rumble? How can I see myself and be myself? Always the road. Always the road. Together at the edges, like spectators to the progress of my journey. How the road and the rocks cannot harbor the small tenderness of early shoots. Aunt Meg's eyes see a long black road, a long black desire with a cruel mouth. The road is a winked out waste, the dwindling dream of a memory which ripens each year into something else. After the harvest, we will go to the orchard and collect the windfallen apples, the worthless ones no market would want. We will call them a boon and satisfy ourselves with apple sauce, apple butter, in the stiff twilight of autumn afternoons. Wasps and beetles will feast upon the ones we leave behind. The road, I think, is visible from each of its banks. Is it the same? Does this jar of fireflies answer me?
very like Mr. Houdini. And strange people sat in folding chairs watching the show. They were not like people I had known. They were terrified that I was to die. The entire room was heavy and poised. Some women, I think, fainted away. I could hear their gasps and moans. And I could see them, too. But my vision was blurry, and their faces looked green and blue and fuzzy and white around the edges. I could see through the milk can. I could see them and the terror on their faces. In the background, I could hear a large clock ticking in the background. Yeah, tick, tock, tick, tock, tick, tock, all the rhythm of it. Tick, tock, tick, tock, monstrous rhythm, on and on and on. Trains, trains, wheels, grating wheels moving over the ground. Tick, tock, tick, tock. And it seems that perhaps I could see the clock out of the corner of my eye. And it resembled a pocket watch hanging in the air outside of the tank. And it reminded us of our father's watch, which I remember him glancing at just before he left on that last train. The audience in the dream, oh, they were ticking and talking and heaving and throbbing, but I knew I had all the time in the world if I needed it. They all thought that I was going to drown, because, of course, certainly they could not know that I had grown some gills while I was in the milk can. You know what I learned from that dream? Not a damn thing. No, no, nothing at all. Nothing to be known, nothing to be seen, nothing heard on that last trip. Goodbye, goodbye. What you got there, little girl? Jar of fireflies? It did. Let me see that. Let me see. Kitty, I can smell by your yearning that the roadman has got you in his mind. Let me guess. He's made you a gift. Something wonderful. Something unearthly. Something which makes all your dreams seem small and insignificant. But perhaps this gift has been stolen from you, eh? Perhaps you've begun to doubt the roadman? Perhaps so many voices have told you so many stories that you now don't know who to believe. Still, something pulls your spirit from out of its cave. Whispers to it in the night. Whispers like an old man. An old man! Old man! What does he say? What does he say? Say he does what? He does say what? Say what he does. Let's roll the dice and play a game. Roll them on and on. Over that road and into the horizon far away. He says, come on. Leave this world behind. I know we almost seduced your Aunt Margaret once. But then, she always had an unspeakable wanderlust anyhow. Bet you didn't know that she left for a while and joined the circus. Oh yeah. But you know, that long, lonesome life left her limpid, lonesome, lonely life. hints of it's the devil. You must know how biblical interpretation can cloud the mind. You must know how she sees the world through a fishbowl. Too old, too old, too old, too cold, too cold, too old, too old. Once, my travels had a powerful magician. He gave to me a secret spell to recapture dreams. I must have it here somewhere. Listen, listen, and I shall regale you with it. First, you must go out of doors at the next quarter moon to a place of both still and falling water. The old mill pond behind Avis McNaught's house will work. Take with you on that night a piece of burlap wrapped around the Bible verse from Deuteronomy. Then you must stick into the bag some feathers. Not chicken feathers now, but songbird feathers. Take the entire assembly and dip it into a pool of hot wax. After the wax dries, pick off your shoes and throw the bag out into the pond. Take a look at where you threw it, and I guarantee you'll get a message from beyond. Or at least a satisfying ripple. You should look lovely in the moonlight. Lovely? Lovely! Tell us again! I'm just fooling with you, Penny. You don't need spells. All you need to know is right there in those hands. Right there in that jar. Right in those hands around that jar. See, the Roadman is just a messenger. Just a messenger. You must do the necessary interpretation. Give you one little hint, though. If you think that the Roadman is here to tell you about coming and going, about walking the earth like a gypsy spirit, about adventuring your way into memory, you're gone. You must be whole before you go. You must be whole before you go. You must be whole before you go. The road answers no questions. The road gives us no answers. What you have now is what you will return with.
Penina was played by Leona Fouts. Micah was realized by Miss Penina Finger. Aunt Mag was played by Carol Maitland. Mr. Knott was essayed by Silas Tomkyns, understudy Gregory Crosby. Joshua was played by David McCarthy. Theater Invisible has presented The Roadman, an original one-act play by M.L.E. Derrick. Thank you very much.